The ocean is Earth's life support system. No ocean, no us. My name is Sylvia Earle. For most of my life, I've had the joy of exploring the sea, studying the living systems that make our lives possible. But what I've seen in my lifetime is slipping away. It's now a race against time to find solutions. Today, a new generation of heroes are showing us what needs to be done to restore health to the ocean. Creating a perpetual planet for generations to come.
Fantastic.
This is where I first fell in love with the ocean as a kid. It was here that I first breathed air underwater. And for me, it was transformative. I thought, this is going to be so great. I can get to see the fish and watch them and see what they do. What happened was the fish came over and started looking at me. I thought, oh, wait a minute. It's supposed to be the other way around, right? Since I first breathed air underwater, I've been a part of the greatest era of exploration in the history of humankind. I've lived underwater for weeks at a time.
She has witnessed firsthand parts of our planet most could barely imagine.
I've helped design and build submersibles to explore further and deeper than ever before.
For the first time, a woman walks the seafloor beyond 1,000 feet.
It's a pleasure to introduce a scientist, an engineer, a teacher, and an explorer.
And founded organizations to explore and protect the sea.
Her deepness, Dr. Sylvia Earle.
But this era of discovery has been accompanied by immense loss.
If we continue business as usual, we're in real trouble.
We used to think the ocean was too vast for humans to harm. We were wrong. We've squandered the treasures of nature, pushing the ocean to the brink of collapse. But I still have great hope. Across the globe, a network of scientists are building on my life's mission to save the ocean.
For me, Sylvia Earle is an inspiration. We all are following her footsteps. She's allowed for so many more people, like from my generation, to move forward and advance their work.
Their pioneering work has taken our knowledge to new heights and depths of understanding. Now we know what previous generations could not know.
We're entering another mass extinction. We're losing species at an alarming rate.
We are the scientists who know what's going on, and it's our responsibility to make people aware for the sake of the planet and our own future.
Together, they are creating a global movement, and we all can be a part of it. Protecting the ocean as if our lives depend on it. Because they do.
When I first began exploring, I marveled at the abundance of life that thrives in healthy coral reefs. But today, coral reef systems around the world are disappearing.
This is about as bad as it gets. It was like looking at the face of climate change. There it is. Reefs are dying, and this is evidence of it right here.
If we don't act now, coral reefs may be gone by the end of the century. Seen from space, the Great Barrier Reef is the largest living structure on Earth. The corals here are among the most diverse in the world. But in recent years, the impacts of climate change have wiped out up to 30%. Coral biologist Dr. Emma Kapp witnessed these tragic events firsthand.
I feel that I have a responsibility to speak up for coral reefs. That's been my area of passion and research, and do what I can to protect and guard that ecosystem.
Climate change and other human activities are destroying coral reefs globally. Warmer, more acidic, low-oxygen seawater is threatening their very existence.
Whilst we're rapidly changing the environment, we're with that learning how corals can or cannot survive with that change.
To help save what's left, Emma and her team have set up the first multi-species coral nursery here to restore coral abundance and diversity. Coral fragments are carefully transplanted onto metal frames.
This has been really successful. We've had, I think, now over 14,000 corals outplanted in just under a year.
This method of transplanting coral cuttings has already been adopted on other reefs around the world. The only long-term solution to save corals is mitigating climate change. Until then, these coral nurseries help buy reefs time. A few years ago, Emma and her team made another extraordinary breakthrough in the fight to save coral reefs. They found corals thriving in extreme conditions.
One area where we found corals surviving where we wouldn't normally look was in mangrove lagoons. It's unusual because the conditions are warmer, more acidic, and have lower oxygen. That's what we're predicting to intensify under climate change. Finding these corals that have some enhanced resilience gives me some much needed hope that we can have at least some corals into the future.
These groundbreaking discoveries are already being shared with scientists around the world. Working together to future-proof this precious ecosystem for generations to come.
So I want to be able to say to my children and the future generations that, you know, I did everything that I could to try to conserve these systems and to try and motivate and educate and encourage those around us to also conserve these ecosystems so that they aren't lost, so it wasn't a privilege that just us were able to experience.
Today, the impact of climate change is being felt everywhere on Earth. Nowhere is this more apparent than in the frozen parts of the planet. Here, in Antarctica, melting ice is opening up this once pristine environment. Exposing marine life to unexpected forms of pollution, we're just beginning to understand.
It's beautiful, isn't it, just to listen to nature. The more diverse the soundscape is, the more it tells us about its health.
Bioacoustician Professor Michel André has developed pioneering technology, unlocking the sound of the ocean, revealing a vast soundscape of life undetectable to human ears.
Light doesn't penetrate more than a few meters below the surface, so the only way the inhabitants of the sea have to communicate, to orientate, to get information is through sounds. Whales produce these rumble sounds, similar to what you hear with an elephant. This very low frequency rumble, something like. And it allows these whales to communicate at very long distances, sometimes hundreds of kilometers.
But as Michel learned to listen to these voices, he also discovered they are drowned out by human noise.
Contaminating this channel of communication with noise from human activity, in particular shipping. If we prevent them to exchange information, we condemn them to death.
In the last 50 years, noise in most of the ocean has doubled every decade. Shipping, industrial fishing, and surveying for fossil fuel has dramatically intensified. And it's not just killing the mammals.
10 years ago, we made a shocking discovery. It wasn't just large marine mammals like whales and dolphins that were impacted by noise pollution. Thousands of invertebrate species may suffer and die from it. We were totally surprised. We could not believe it. You feel responsible, not only to demonstrate that is an effect, but to propose to society a solution for that.
To tackle the impact of noise pollution, Michel has developed technology that listens live to the sounds of the sea.
This is the first time. This is a new device. It's a prototype that we did specially designed for this expedition. And this little baby is going to record the sound of the Antarctic.
This autonomous boy transmits data in real time from one of the last places on Earth with zero noise pollution.
It comes with this bittersweet feeling that we might not be able to do it again in the future.
This technology will become a part of a global network of listening stations around the world, known as LIDO, or Listen to the Deep Ocean. It offers the first truly global picture of ocean noise and its effects.
The beauty of this technology is that it is listening to the ocean 24 hours a day, every day, every month, every year.
The ability to listen is revealing exactly where we must reduce noise, protecting vital habitats.
I hope that this listening station that we are developing and deploying around the world will help many people to hear the message. My feeling is not fear. My feeling is on the contrary. I believe that what we are doing is bringing a solution, is bringing something that the next generation will know how to use.
This technology that was born in the ocean is now monitoring biodiversity on the land, revealing the impact of human activity on wildlife around the world. Undersea noise pollution is like a death of a thousand cuts. But it's just one of many problems facing the ocean. In my lifetime, industrial fishing has eliminated 90% of many different species of wild ocean animals. Some of Earth's most majestic creatures are being pushed to extinction. But with the right protection, species can recover. From the smallest squid and shrimp to the biggest fish in the sea.
First time I saw a whale shark, it was like a bus underwater coming towards me, and I was in awe. You almost feel insignificant because of their sheer size. And yet these animals that are massive and they've been around forever are endangered.
Marine biologist Dr. Brad Norman and his colleagues have helped develop technology to monitor this highly elusive giant of the deep.
Their numbers have declined by more than 50% over the last 75 years.
Driven to the brink of extinction by humans due to hunting and ship collisions.
If we do nothing now, there is a big risk we're going to lose this species forever. This is not something that I want to happen on my watch.
Yeah, this is Magellan, go ahead, over. Just keep an eye on him, we'll be there as quick as we can.
Like many threatened species, in order to protect them, we need to understand them.
We want to know if climate change is having an effect, how it's going to affect the animals in their movement.
To answer this vital question, Brad and his team are using electronic tags to track whale shark movements and monitor their behavior.
Tagging the biggest fish in the sea is not that easy. We have to be very calm.
The tag is clamped harmlessly onto the dorsal fin. This reveals unique insights into what they're doing when they're out of sight.
We've recorded whale sharks moving along the WA coast, all the way north to Indonesia, and all the way south, below Perth.
Well, that's great, guys. Well done.
Ah, that's good.
Perfect.
Along with tagging, Brad and his team have also developed a pioneering photo monitoring system.
The spots on the skin of each whale shark is unique. We can identify individuals similar to a fingerprint in humans.
By photographing the unique pattern, Brad can track the return migration of individuals. Anyone with an underwater camera can now play a part in helping to conserve whale sharks globally. By adapting an algorithm NASA uses to map stars in the night sky, Brad and his colleagues have produced a database with over 75,000 sightings from 54 countries.
To be able to break new ground on something that was so big and so amazing, yet so little known, it was a dream come true, really.
And this star mapping technology is also being adapted to help other species on the edge of extinction.
We need to keep learning.
And as technology is advancing, we have so many more tools to help our understanding of whale sharks, of their environment, and ultimately how we're going to protect them.
Saving the ocean now depends on scientists from all disciplines and nations working together. We are fighting a battle on many fronts, and to really win, we must keep exploring.
There's still so much about the ocean that we have no idea about. The deep ocean, we know less about that than we do about space.
Even today, we've only mapped 15% of the ocean.
The purpose of the exploration is to acquire a better knowledge, understanding how it works, how species interact, discovering new species.
Exploring the unknown is now more important than ever. We cannot protect what we don't know. Marine biologist Dr. Vrene Hasserman has dedicated her life to exploring one of the last wildernesses on Earth.
We were the first to look at everything, trying to understand what species are living there and how they live together.
In these remote fjords in Patagonia, she's been tackling one of the biggest challenges of all: the threat to Earth's biodiversity.
Down there in the darkness, the first couple of meters, generally it's really green and dark. And then you suddenly get into a clearer area. There's many secrets hidden down there. It's our responsibility to explore what's down in the ocean and to show people what we find.
Using new robotic technology, they've gone further and deeper. Finding previously unknown species that have lived here for millennia.
When we saw the corals for the first time, it's like, What is that? That looks like a coral? Why would a coral be in the cold water?
We don't find them in any other places in whole Patagonia, so it's really interesting. It's a very special area.
Oh. The bright lights made everything look just snowy. It looked so snowy. So it was really exciting because nobody had known they were there. For a biologist to discover this is the dream of your whole life.
Rene's discoveries astonished the world. It led to the first comprehensive field guide featuring over 500 fjord species. Rene had uncovered a hidden world no one knew existed.
This took 10 years of work and brought together people from 25 countries, and they all helped to describe the species from Chile and Patagonia, which was a really big effort because there was very few literature about these species.
But as Rene has continued exploring, she's also witnessed a frightening transformation.
When I first arrived in the fjord here in 2003, there were only 3 small salmon farms. Within about 10 years, they were popping up everywhere.
Pollution from salmon farms and the impact of climate change are having disastrous consequences on this delicately balanced ecosystem.
The changes were really serious. It started us being really worried about the future of the fjord.
In recent years, there have been mass die-offs everywhere, including fish, jellyfish, starfish, and even whales.
We saw a big coral mortality. 99% of the corals died off, and they haven't recovered since then.
What is happening in Patagonia is taking place everywhere. Globally, a species is lost approximately every 10 minutes. This loss of biodiversity matters to us all.
It's like a ball of threads where all the species are connected. If we start losing species because they are going extinct, we're kind of cutting the threads, and that makes the whole ball unstable. The whole ecosystem can break down, and we have really no control what happens.
Rene's discoveries have revealed the true value of life in the fjords, helping her prove to the Chilean government how vital it is to protect what's left.
The danger is really here that we are losing species that we don't even know yet. We have to start really understanding the ecosystems and trying to describe the diversity so that we can start to protect it, because the diversity is as important as the climate for the planet.
There's no planet B. No other planet where there's so much life.
And if we destroy this planet, we don't have more chances. We need to do something now.
I've spent most of my life exploring the deepest parts of the ocean. I've helped design and build innovative technology to go deeper and stay longer under the sea.
Here we are, more than 1,000 feet down. It's 304.2 meters down, and it's dark. It's wonderfully dark.
The ocean below 100 meters or so makes up 90% of all space occupied by life on Earth. And yet most of it is yet to be seen or explored. To understand and care for the ocean, we must go deeper. And also build new technology, enabling us to stay underwater for longer.
Like space, this environment is not made for man. It's a world full of mystery.
Time underwater is a unique gift, offering scientists an opportunity to monitor and protect our rapidly vanishing world.
There was a dream to create a new scientific observatory to have a better understanding of the rules that drive the ocean.
Explorer Guillaume Bordeaux is leading a 4-year scientific expedition around the world, using creative technology to monitor the negative consequences of climate change on marine life.
We decided to sell our house. We sold everything, everything we had. But we did it, we took the risk. We just sailed from south to north. We did hundreds and hundreds of dives.
Along their 50,000-mile journey, they've dived under the Arctic ice caps and collaborated with over 40 international scientists. Their latest expedition has brought them to the remote waters of the South Pacific.
Since a kid, I've been inspired by pioneers like Sylvia Earle, and they work with underwater habitats.
Guillaume and his team have designed a capsule that allows them to no longer count dives in hours, but days.
We have the idea to create a new scientific observatory adapted to our time.
The capsule's design leaves no footprint on the ocean floor, so it can be placed anywhere in the world.
No noise, no pollution. With this approach, you can get a better understanding of the ocean, of what's happening down there.
Staying underwater for days at a time has enabled the team to monitor previously hidden changes.
We could see the life of the reef, which is like a town. You can follow a fish from where he wakes up in the morning. How they move away and they disappear for a few minutes or hours, and then they come back. The chance to live underwater, literally, to spend day and night living underwater with the fishes, it's not a common experience. It's not an easy one also, but it's incredibly rare and rich.
These long-term observations are already providing vital data for a dozen international research institutions. Gilan hopes the capsule will be used throughout the world to continue to monitor the impact of climate change.
With the capsule program, it's only the beginning. I do believe that our imagination has continuously to be associated with technologies. And that way, we can create new tools to have a modern understanding of the ocean and to preserve not only the ocean, but us.
To save the ocean, we must keep exploring. But for change to be permanent, we must pass our knowledge on to this generation and the next.
We need to start with the children and hand on the knowledge, and all the children need to be aware of the situation and the risk of their future so that they can help to make the necessary changes.
I think it's important that the new generation learn from what's been done and what needs to be improved upon, and getting kids involved in science and ocean protection.
Our future depends on our ability to capture hearts and minds.
Do you have a question for Shannon the Shark or the amazing Dr. Sylvia Earle?
What sort of animals have you seen underwater while diving?
Good question.
Oh, well, I have seen sperm whales come back to the surface after they've been thousands of feet down, and they still have squid tentacles. They've been running out like spaghetti, you know?
All right, go grab yourself a...
Both fists.
Both knuckles.
If every one of us learns to love and care for the sea, we can win the battle to save the ocean. In Peru, this ability to ignite passion for the sea is helping save one of their most threatened species.
I remember I was out in the water. Just looking out in the blue. And then, out of the sudden, one of the fishermen spots it. Giant manta rays, for me, are magical. They're so powerful, but they're so gentle. They're just majestic.
Marine biologist Kirsten Forsberg has been studying these gentle giants. Reaching over 7 meters in length, they can tell us about the health of the ocean as a whole.
If you see a giant manta ray, you know that it's coming there because it's a healthy ecosystem that it's feeding on.
But fishing and hunting have put them at risk.
Giant mantas are vulnerable species that's threatened worldwide, that has a population that's decreasing up to 30% globally, and in some places up to 80%.
Kirsten's mission is to find new ways of protecting this vulnerable species by involving every member of her local community.
It's about connecting people to the species and connecting people to the ocean.
Kirsten and her team work with local fishermen to find alternative income through ecotourism and to value them as living treasures.
They're worth far more in the ocean alive because people will come and they will see them and they will want more people, more tourists to come and will just build the whole ecotourism industry.
But to make sure changes are sustainable, Kirsten is doing even more, raising awareness with the next generation.
Everybody can make a difference, everybody, starting from a 2-year-old kid.
Working with over 50 local schools and engaging with hundreds of thousands of people throughout Peru, Kirsten has empowered the next generation to lead their own campaigns. Her success has since inspired other youth movements around the world.
I tell all the kids that we work with, you don't have to be a biologist or a conservationist to change the world. You can change the world from whatever career or path that you decide to take in life.
In a place where mantas were once hunted to near extinction, Kirsten's showing how real change can happen. Today, it is now illegal to capture, sell, or eat mantas in Peru.
For me, sharing knowledge and working together is key. We need to be all together. Everybody wants to live in a healthy planet. Everybody can make a difference.
When I was a child, most people thought the ocean was too big to fail. Now we know it is in trouble, and therefore, so are we. Currently, less than 10% is protected. But to stand a chance of saving the blue heart of the planet, we must protect at least 30%. And there's a place in the Indian Ocean that is cause for hope. The Seychelles is part of a global network of hope spots. Created by the nonprofit organization Mission Blue, these are places critical to the health of the ocean that need protection and care.
Angelique.
Hi, Sylvia.
How are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
Good
How
to
are
see you?
You.
I'm so glad you're here. You're all champions.
Each hope spot starts with a champion, like Angelique, who has empowered everyone from the grassroots up to take action.
The Seychelles often sees itself as a laboratory. You can test whether something would work. And from there, we can inspire others to say, it does work, it's your turn to take action.
There are some impressive projects here. Today, a youth-led beach cleanup is collecting tons of trash washed up from all over the world. Elsewhere, fishermen remove rubbish from the reefs. Others have voluntarily stopped fishing for 6 months.
Fishers, who typically would have been taking out of the ocean, they want to pilot for the very first time a temporary fish closure. And in fact, we'll collect data about the impact of a closure to be able to inform policy.
And particularly exciting for me, scientists are surveying seagrass meadows to calculate their role in capturing and storing carbon from the atmosphere. What's incredible is how the whole country has taken action. Including the president himself.
And it just shows you the amount of areas that we have protected.
It's paradise. You know, when I first came here, you were 2 years old.
Wow. Wow.
It was 1964. There was no protection for the ocean.
No, no, no.
Zero.
Zero protection.
But people thought we didn't need protection.
Today, 30% of the waters surrounding the Seychelles are protected by law. 10 years ahead of global targets.
The time has come for us to act. And you have been there. We need to listen to you and continue to listen to the scientists around the world.
People of this small nation are showing the world how one action times 10, times 1,000, times 1,000,000 makes change.
It's great to see that there's still fish in large numbers here. And not just one species, but at least a dozen in this one area.
Beautiful.
Ooh, that was a nice one, huh?
Yeah.
I think I want to be one of them. Plenty of reason for hope. We're diving the hope spot after all.
The Seychelles is just one of a growing number of hope spots. 130 so far, inspiring people around the planet to use their power to restore and protect the blue heart of the planet. One of the latest is where I lived as a child in Dunedin, Florida.
Thank you, all of you. You all have a key role using your superpowers to see the recovery and celebrate it. You have to cut the ribbon, right?
3, 2, 1!
Declaring this as Florida Gulf Coast Hope Spot gives me special satisfaction, because this is where, for me, it started. There are 130 hope spots now around the world. All of them really matter.
Our fate and the oceans are one. With every drop of water you drink, every breath you take, you are connected to the sea. It's what makes all life on Earth possible. Thanks to a global network of scientists innovating, educating, and exploring, we know what we need to do.
Trying to actually communicate the science so that people understand the value of these ecosystems and what it means if we lose them is so important.
Each and every one of us can make a difference. I call upon all of you to do your part. You could be an explorer, discovering hidden worlds before they're lost.
This capacity to listen to sound and to explore the environment is allowing us to get a little bit closer to understanding how it works and how we can save it.
Or you can be an inventor building new technology to explore the ocean.
It's going to take innovative technology and the biggest and best scientists around the world
to protect and save our oceans.
Or you can be the teacher, inspiring others to make a difference.
For me, it's not just about exchanging knowledge from peer to peer, but it's really about exchanging knowledge from one generation to the other.
Or you can be the one with hope, showing that anyone can change everything.
Now, there's a chance, and that's what I'm working flat out to achieve, that in the future they'll look back and say, thank you, 21st century humans, you did get it.
Together, we can create a perpetual planet.